Hey, it's Max and Ryan here from Trish Reviews, and we've got the new 16-inch MacBook Pro for testing. We've only had it in for a few days, but what do you think so far, Max?
Yeah, so these are kind of our first impressions. I've been using it for about 48 hours, probably a little bit longer once you're watching this video, and yeah, obviously not enough time for full-on testing, full-on benchmarks. There's kind of a lot going on here, yep. From the new chipset to the new screen to the new design. Mm-hmm. So yeah, these are just kind of some general first thoughts I've had. Not going to touch on the performance stuff too much. I know Ryan's going to talk a little bit about the kind of new chips, the M1 Pro and the M1 Max. But yeah, kind of general thoughts. I really like it. I think obviously it's a high-end, high-priced laptop, mm-hmm. aimed at kind of the more creative market. If you're someone, even if you're someone like me, probably like you, yep. kind of majority of work is word processing, kind of basic photo editing, that kind of stuff. I would probably just ignore this completely. Like, this laptop isn't for you.
That's way too expensive, right?
I think kind of judging it on the price, where you think, oh, that's way overpriced. Mm-hmm. But a lot of the features that Apple has added in here kind of show that it is listening, I think.
Yeah, definitely.
Obviously, the last big MacBook redesign, kind of 2015, was radical in that it ditched all the ports, went full on USB-C, added in the touch bar, kind of really focused on thinning everything down.
Yep.
And as soon as I took this out of the box, the first thing that strikes you is kind of how, maybe not how big it is, but how much bigger it is than the last MacBook Pros. Mm-hmm. And you know, you probably think of that as being, oh, it's thick, it's heavy, but it kind of felt nice. It felt nice to have something that they'd not just sacrificed performance and port and usability features to make it really thin. So on the side, you've got, along with the three Thunderbolt 4 ports, you've got the new MagSafe connector, which yep. enables fast charging on the 16-inch model, headphone jack as well. And then you've got an SD card reader as well on the side, and an HDMI 2.0 port. So while some people, if your kind of workflow includes CF cards and stuff like that, you're still gonna need dongles. But I think for the majority of people using this, you won't need to add anything extra. And immediately, kind of in the first few days of using it, I've already used the SD card slot, I've already used the HDMI port to plug it into a monitor, and you know, it's just little things like that that show Apple was probably listening more than people would expect it to.
Do you think the problem is no USB-A here?
While I think going back and adding the HDMI and the SD card slot were something that Apple could do, I don't think going back to the old, much slower USB-A ports is probably needed. All of Apple's devices now come with USB-C cables. I think the majority of things are moving that way. Obviously, there are some legacy things that do use the USB-A port, but if you're kind of talking about speed and stuff, having these USB-C port Thunderbolt 4 ports is just so much more useful for a wider array of products.
I can always use an adapter if you're going to plug in a mouse.
So, yeah, I mean, you probably still get an adapter or two.
Yeah.
But other things that you kind of notice straight away are the screen, and obviously the thing that people were talking about on the night was the notch.
Divisive, it's a bit strange, I do think.
But it does look slightly strange. Obviously the reason for it is that you've got these much slimmer bezels surrounding the screen, and obviously because people tend to use webcams a lot more now, the previous MacBook webcams were pretty terrible. 720p, really bad color reproduction, super blurry. So you've now got a 1080p webcam in the front, and the webcam's really good. Mm-hmm. It's probably not quite on par with the iMac webcam, but it's kind of similar. For me, I don't care that much about webcam quality.
Yeah.
So I probably would have taken a kind of similar bezel the whole way around rather than it. But I know lots of people do like webcams, obviously kind of in this era where there's more Zoom meetings. Mm-hmm.
It's nice to have a bit more clarity.
I feel like it was probably the right decision to make, even if you do have that notch in the display.
Have you noticed any software issues of notch? Like, I've seen screenshots online of like certain menus being blocked out. Have you had any of that?
I think that kind of always is the case. It was the case when they added the notch to the iPhone. Mm-hmm. There were some apps that kind of didn't work around it. Sometimes the macOS software maybe isn't quite optimized for it yet. Where it does differ from the phone is that, so you're watching a video, obviously there's black bars at the top anyway, so that doesn't make a difference there. The majority of the time it just cuts into the taskbar along the top, so it doesn't really cut into what you're doing. it's definitely going to be more of an eyesore to some than actually an inconvenience.
Okay, cool. Going back to the screen, so it's got mini LED technology.
Yeah.
It's hard to kind of, without people seeing in person, seeing how, what kind of improvements, and you've used it with the iPad Pro, how big of an upgrade is this?
I think if you're used to any sort of OLED display on a TV or a phone, iPhone, Samsung Galaxy S21, you'll kind of know the benefits of OLED, so those really deep inky blacks, excellent contrast, bright vivid colors, far better saturation, stuff like that. And you know, I've never used a laptop with an OLED display. I know you've used a couple. Yep. Mini LED is kind of similar to OLED, just slightly obviously easier for Apple to produce, it seems. And the screen here is excellent. What it does have over OLEDs at this size, it tends to get a lot brighter. So Apple's stating 1600 nits for HDR content. But majority of the time, you're probably going to be sitting around that 500 nit point, obviously sitting fairly close to a laptop. You don't want it to be that bright. But yeah, the screen is gorgeous. It's got ProMotion as well, so it can adapt to 120 hertz. I didn't think that was as instantly noticeable as I found it on the iPad and the iPhone, but obviously it's still nice to have. You can also change it. So if you just want it 60 hertz, if you're editing footage, 24, whatever, you can change it to that as well. And same with color profiles. So there's obviously the one that Apple does by default, kind of amps up colors a little bit more than maybe some people would want, but there's, if you have a specific workflow, if you have an HDR workflow, or a P3 workflow, you can choose those in the settings. So there's a lot of customizability with the screen.
Cool.
But obviously, one of the biggest new additions and why this kind of laptop got a lot of attention was the new chips inside. Ryan, I know you've looked at the chips a lot. This one is running the M1 Pro.
Yes, that's right.
So, yeah. And there's an M1 Max as well. So what's the difference between them? What kind of performance can we expect from these machines?
Cool. So both the M1 Pro and the M1 Max are Apple Silicon processors, and they've got the same, if you're going for the Max version of each one, the 10-core CPU, so you can expect a similar CPU performance, probably better with the, obviously, M1 Max. But the biggest difference between them really is the GPU cores within this single chip. So the M1 Max here has about 16 GPU cores, while the M1 Max has 32 GPU cores. Obviously, the M1 Max configuration is a lot more expensive, so you're going to really need to like make use of that kind of the extra GPU power here to make it worthwhile. So I think for most people, the M1 Pro is the better bet because you're still getting a very good integrated graphics performance.
Yeah.
We haven't done the tests for the graphics just yet, so wait until our final review to get the full impressions of that. But like from what I've seen and heard so far, it's very good. Kind of GPU power for like your content creation, like video editing, any kind of basic stuff like that, it should be powerful enough, unless you're going to like something really powerful if you're working like professional studios or anything more. We have done some early benchmark tests for the CPU with Geekbench 5. Again, this is just one benchmark test so far. We'll be doing more, so again, more full analysis performance for the review, but the early signs are very promising. So we did our test for Geekbench on both single core and multi-core performance, and they were the best scores I've seen in any laptop we've reviewed in the last 2 or 3 years. And that's really impressive. So this is including like big, monstrous, huge gaming laptops, or they're kind of saying they want to have like equivalent desktop performances. This beat all those gaming laptops, and yeah, it's just kind of a remarkable performance, especially, I wouldn't call this laptop lightweight and thin, in the grand scheme, but for the performance level it's offering, it is like the gaming laptops you'll see are far heavier and far bigger. So yeah, I think I'm really impressed with the performance so far.
Yeah.
Really encouraging signs, and I'm excited to find out more about it. Really.
I guess we probably should caveat and say that this is not being aimed at gamers.
No, of course not.
Obviously macOS is not particularly optimized for gaming. No. There's limited support for top titles. While we've kind of done a few benchmark tests in some supported games, you're not going to get that wide variety. And while there are all those GPU cores available, again, this is far more aimed at people who have HDR video editing workflows, content creation, stuff like that, Logic Pro, music production.
Yeah, just because it has that GPU power doesn't mean it can run AAA games. You need the software for that. So obviously best of Windows. But if you're talking about video editing and animations like that, then again, early days, but this is probably one of the best options you can buy.
And I think we were kind of always expecting that, weren't we, after the exceptional performance we saw from the base M1, that kind of, it had Geekbench scores that we'd never seen before. Yes. On laptops that were £1,000. So I think we were always expecting this to really blitz those synthetic benchmarks. Mm-hmm. And obviously benchmarks are one thing, but we want to see how well it performs in day-to-day use, in yes. video workflows and stuff like that. So yeah, there are more to come on the performance, but a great start. One thing I did want to kind of touch upon slightly was the pricing. Mm-hmm. Obviously, it's an expensive machine. It's aimed at professional market. While the initial prices kind of were what I was expecting, things like the RAM upgrades and that kind of side of things are very expensive. Yes. So if you want to kind of jump from 16 to 32 gig of memory, that's a lot of the jump. Also, if you want to really up that SSD, those prices are a lot. And obviously you can't change it after the fact. So
yeah.
If you want more storage, if you want more unified memory, then you know, you're gonna be paying a lot from that initial asking price.
I think when I was experimenting with the pricing and I pushed it up to 8 terabytes of SSD, that the price difference was almost like a laptop in itself. So yeah, it's, if you're gonna push up the specs, you're prepared to pay a lot of money.
Yeah. So yeah, obviously expensive laptop, but I think the more egregious pricing does come from the addition of more memory and stuff. So something to look out for. So even after using this laptop for just a couple of days, there are some things that really do stand out. Obviously the screen, really nice. I do like the new design. The keyboard's excellent. Apple never really used the touch bar for anything worthwhile, so I don't necessarily think getting rid of it's a bad thing. I do like the kind of extra height function around the top. Still no touchscreen. Mm-hmm. Are we ever going to get a touchscreen Mac?
I doubt it, but we'll
doesn't seem like so at this rate.
It seems they're cutting out the gimmicks and just focusing on essentials, and that's more than good enough for me.
And you know, things like, I like, it's nice having the MagSafe connector back.
Yep.
The fast charging seems really good.
Yep.
Battery life, again, we're going to need more time, but I've been using it all day today, and it's not dropped too much. So yeah, lots of good first impressions, but also a lot more testing needs to be done. Mm-hmm. Obviously, if you guys have any questions, anything you want us to run, any particular benchmarks or tests or things you want us to try, leave them in the comments below and we'll try and get around to it during this review process. I think we're going to take our time, mm-hmm. really test it and see kind of how this compares to the price. So yeah, thanks for watching. Thanks for joining me, Ryan, yep. And we'll see you in the next video.